first driver of the day, before the guns get there, I like to just give the dogs a burnout. It's a quick two-minute burnout just to run around. And then I put them back in the car and I bring them out as I need to work them when I'm picking up. So I'll bring some youngsters and I'll bring some older dogs. So the youngsters can sit with the older dogs. They can hear the shots. They can get used to the noise. And yet they've got the comfort of the other dogs. So then I'll put them all back in. This is the beginning of the season on the shoot.
The day begins.
All your hard work will now show you whether you've been doing it right and you've done enough of it. Have you got those dogs ready to work? Will they work under great temptation? Will they listen to you in the field, or will they think for themselves? Have you got the control on those dogs? And that's the important thing. Can you handle that dog on a blind? Anybody can pick a seen bird, but can you handle that dog on a blind? So I've got down to the first drive and nobody's there. So I take the dog out of the car and I actually use it as a training aid. The dog knows we're on a shoot. The drive will be up. It'll know what it's about. And now I'm going to see if it'll listen to me when I give it basic commands. I'll send it out in a straight line. I'll push it back. I'll handle it, and I want to see if that dog's sharp. Then I'm going to just turn that dog round, and I'm going to bring it back. And it's so important, I bring it back, and it just forgets everything that it thinks that's out there. Because it's on the shoot, it's done it before. It thinks there's a bird out there. It's got to stop, turn round, look at me, and come back when told. Even without something in its mouth, it mustn't carry on hunting. So before the guns get into place, in the next field over, I've just used it as an exercise, a training exercise. I'm always training with my dogs, even when they're working on the shoot. It's still training. It's making sure you've got everything in order and it's all working properly. Because I line her up, look, she actually believes there's something out there, because 99% of the time there is something out there. So it's about a trust. It's about going in that straight line and not coming off that straight line till I tell her, but then casting her where I need to cast her. She's got to believe me, else she wouldn't do such a straight line. It's taken months to get to this stage. She used to be hesitant. This is a client's dog, and she used to be hesitant. But once I've got her understanding what I want, she responds really, really well. Yes, I'm pleased the way she listened to me, the way she broke away from going in the direction I told her, coming back when told, and as you can see, she's focused on me. So now let's get onto the drive stuff. So after the drive, and we've picked up in the field, we come out and one of the guns said, I think I've got a bird down in front, and I'm pretty sure I saw it come down, but I didn't know exactly where it was. So I know that he has got a bird down, so I've had to go out into the next field and say, is there anything you want picking up? So he's given me a mark on it, and I roughly know where it came down. I've got to learn to trust the dog, and you must learn to trust your dog. The more experience they get, the better they become. So my position, my body position, is actually telling the dog where I want it to go. That leg standing where it is. But watch this. I don't need to line that dog up, because the dog is telling me it wants to go out there, look. And so the dog is looking with the repetition, the body position of me. She's saying, there's something out in front of us. And so I didn't need to get down and line the dog up. Why would you want to do that if you're going to use it as a shooting dog? If you're going to be a trial dog, they're obsessed with running straight lines. But that dog has gone out there, picked it, and brought it back without any handling. It's a reasonably good straight line. Most picking up people would be over the moon with that. So this next retrieve is, the gun was standing up by the hedge and it's dropped a bird onto the hedge and then walked away. He didn't have a dog, but he said, I've got a bird up on that hedge. So the dog has got to be going out to the hedge and use its own ability to find that bird. My job is to handle it out of the hedge, put it in the direction it needs to go.
Good night. North there. North. I'm taking my little short leg running all the way up there. Take her up there. Dead.
So this Labrador bitch that I'm working went on to win a Labrador trial with the owner, but I was teaching the owner as well as the dog. But at this point, I'm actually giving the dog education. I'm using the chute to educate the dog. Then I really tidy it up for trials. But if your dog's got the experience on the chute and you look after that dog and you don't ruin that dog, you don't let it run around like an headless chicken, you can use the chutes to build that understanding for the dog, because it's in its natural environment. And then when you get to a trial, you won't panic when somebody says, right, you need to send your dog out there. There's a bird 400 yards out in that direction. You just line the dog up, and you've done it a number of times, and the dog will trust you.
That was a nice retrieve. You did all right there.
So the next retrieve, I'm going to send the dog during the drive. She's got to be focused. She's got to have marked it. And I send her, and I want her only picking the bird that I want her to pick.
Hello.
The dog actually saw the bird come down, but if you notice, look, she goes out of sight because it came down and then she couldn't see it. So she was slightly hesitant to begin with, but now she's having to work out of sight. I can't see her. There's no point in screaming. I've got to trust her. I've got to trust that she is doing what I've trained her to do. That's important. So now it's really important that she's watching and she's waiting. She's using her eyes to mark. And if she was looking at me, it would be no good. She needs to be looking out there where the shots are, where the guns are. And she soon learns, hang on, where there's people and there's shot is normally a bird. And that's the important thing. If your dog doesn't mark, how can it get to the fall? It's so important we train in the sequences that I show you. I've been to trials where people have got their dog in the same scenario as this, waiting during a drive, and their dogs spin round and look at the owner. They don't look at nothing in the field because the owner is petrified that they will lose the steadiness and the dog will start thinking for itself. The idea is, if you've trained it right, it should sit there, it should watch what's going on. It should be mad keen to get it, but not go till told. That's the important thing. I work with dogs in the working field, picking up, beating, as well as competition. So I know all sides of the aspect of trialing, how to train a dog for competition and how to train a dog as a shooting dog. A good shooting dog should be a good trial dog. Unfortunately, that's not the case. I positioned myself in the field like this on purpose, knowing that the ridge of that field, that dog is going to be just out of sight and going to have to work it out for itself. I don't want it looking back at me saying, where do you want me to go? I want a straight line out and a straight line back. One of the important things to do is, these guns are shooting birds and dropping some birds right next to the guns. I'm leaving them. The dog can see them down. The dog's got to sit there and wait. You can see the dog's really keen. But if you send the dog for everything that falls out of the sky, you will make it unsteady. It's as simple as that. So the skill set is, you decide when the dog fetches a bird, and you decide when the dog doesn't fetch a bird. The dog doesn't decide, else you're going to come unstuck. If you never send your dog for anything during the drive and only send the dog after the drive, your dog will switch off more, but it won't be so keen, it won't be watching everything, it will just learn to switch off. It will learn just to sit there, and it knows its job. It learns with repetition that nothing happens during the drive, but after the drive it does. But watch this. I didn't send the dog instantly. I waited, I watched the dog, and then I sent the dog, because I want the dog to go straight to the fore and straight back between the two guns. I would not the dog straight back, in and straight back. That was a great moment. Did you see how I reacted very quickly? Because on the way back, a bird dropped just in front of her on the way back, and she looked at it, she went towards it, leave that, get her back to me. But as soon as she comes back to me, she's spinning around saying, it's there, I want that one as well, Dad, I want that one. That's the keenness that I've created, but I've still got the control. She didn't drop the bird in her mouth and go after that one. And it's a good temptation to put the dog in, but you don't want it every day with a young dog. I then sent her for that bird, and that was the reward for listening to me. If you listen to me, you'll enjoy the game. And that is the whole emphasis on how we train. We build it up with gameplay. We use discipline at the right time. I used a verbal correction when I didn't want her to go and pick that. But then I said, right, you've listened to me, now you can have it. A simple retrieve. I could have gone out and picked it myself. But no, I gave her the retrieve for listening.
Learns here is if it behaves itself, it gets positives, it gets the retrieves. If it doesn't behave itself, it gets negatives, it doesn't get the retrieves. So she's going to learn, she's not allowed to go until I say. Even though she sees a bird down close like she's seen, she's not allowed to go until I tell her. But I do want her to mark them, it makes my life so much easier. That's not me screaming, that's John in the background. I'll tell Bill. So that's good temptation for this dog. She's got three guns in front of her, they're dropping birds all around her, and she's having to sit and wait. Sometimes I send her and sometimes I don't. Here comes another bird, look. That one's hit. Watch that one! These will be the last few birds out now in this corner. The beats brought the wood along. I can hear where the dogs are, so I know the drive's nearly over. And then this bottom corner now. The birds do drop back. We've got a runner to go on the floor. Right down the bottom. Coming out of the loft. Please don't. A bit low that one.
So coming towards the end of the drive now, what I'll do now is stay in that field, go and pick those birds that I saw down, the runners, go looking for them and the birds I saw down, and then let her sweep the field. So I'll cast her out in the direction I want her to go, let her look for the birds that I want her to look for, then I'll go back up through the field where the guns have been and sweep that with the dog and let the dog come across anything in the field that's down that we've left for steadiness for training. We don't want to be sending the dog for every retrieve, like I said, else the dog becomes unsteady.
With one of these, you can get loads of these. Get out.
So on that occasion, there was another dog running around down there. The guns were coming up through the valley and there was a distraction, but the dog still got to listen to me. So I had to handle the dog because of the other dog there, and the dog listened to me. So that was good. I used it as an exercise to benefit me.
The potato test. The potato test. Lexi, sit down. Get it. Okay. Laugh there. Laugh.
So she's marked it well, I've sent her for it, she's done a beautiful straight line, straight out and on the way back. Another bird is shot, and if you look on the hedge on the left hand side, as you, there look, it just came in there on the left hand side. She saw it, so I just used the whistle to bring her back into me, and that's what I wanted to pick. So she knows that bird is on the left hand side, she must take no notice of that until after the drive, when we'll pick it after. It's not going nowhere. She's got to go and pick the bird I want her to pick. I love it when a dog focuses what's happening in front but is steady.
Get out. Bugger.
Unfortunately, she switched birds there. You can't blame the dog for that. I sent her and she's come across a bird. She's got to pick that, bring it back in. I then line her up and send her again. It's not the dog's fault. If the dog comes across something, technically it's got to pick it up. I don't want to be stopping it and leave that, fetch that one, go and do that one. At the end of the day, she's learning through association that when I send her in a straight line, if it's there, she's got to pick it. didn't like that bit. Did you notice what happened? She sent for a bird. On the way back, another bird dropped close to her. She looked at it, and I said, leave that. And she came in, no problem. But she just dropped the bird on the floor. She didn't hand it to me. And she's too keen on spinning around and going, I'm marking that one. So that showed me what I've got to work on. It shows me what I've got to polish. Because if that was competition, she'd be put out. She has to give me that bird and wait for the next retrieve. She just can't say, I want that one. But that's what she actually said. You watch these films and you see your problems. You can see what you need to work on.
G'day.
So there you have it, schooling a dog on a shoot. You've trained it to a certain standard. You're now giving it experience. You're actually working for the shoot, picking up those birds, but you're training your dog at the same time. You're not just letting the dog run around like an headless chicken. You're actually using it as a training day. You can't beat it. If you get your dog to a good standard, you can then take it to another level. Another level. And even those last two retrieves, I changed it. It came flapping down. It was flapping. I sent the dog and I wanted to see if she'd stop, and she stopped lovely. And then the next one I sent her on, I directed her right onto it on purpose to see if she's listening to me. All those retrieves that I used on the day was to give that dog experience. I didn't just let the dog run around like a headless chicken doing what it wanted. That way I educated it. I'm giving it more knowledge and understanding for when it went into competition, and that's why the dog did well in competition. I've put up a couple of videos lately where that dog is sticky. You send it and it goes out and it doesn't go out in a straight line without any hesitation. That's that messy middle that I talk about, that sometimes you put the dog in because you're putting the dog under pressure. Sometimes you've got to lay that pressure off and let that confidence come up. And the confidence comes up with those straight line retrieves. Those straight line retrieves are brilliant. Other people have to keep the dog on the lead during the drive and then let the dog go at the end of the drive so they don't disturb the guns. What I can do is I can work that dog and train that dog on the day, on the shoot, and fully give that dog the understanding and the experience that it needs. I hope you enjoyed that video.